Get a good look at it. Ooh, so thick. Now I know what it called it, a fatty. And oh, shit, so sick. Got a hit and picked up a habit. But that's alright, 'cause you're all mine. Oh, go on, show 'em who you call daddy. I guess they're just my cause, girl, they wish they had it. Ooh, my killer, my thriller. Yeah, you're a classic.
Wait, I think it's Wednesday. Great start. Happy Wednesday. I usually always get that right. Yasmin. Hey, always here first. Hayden with a raid. That's so kind of you. I was literally just hanging out over there. You know it. Mom said it's my turn to go live. So today, We're going to do something different. Different than things I've done previously, because it's a new year, and it's a new me. Not really, but different things will be happening. It's not my two-year anniversary yet. That happens on the 6th. We still got 2 days until my anniversary, so until then I can still be old-school me, for sure. I hope my comment doesn't go up on screen, because I have to say that I have to go to the bathroom. Now's the time. Now's the time before we get into our classes. Hey, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yes, shout out Daddy Daldo. Of course. Always. Still hoping one day I get partners so that we can create our little team. Even though nobody uses teams anymore. I still want to make a team. So, I found this free class for bartending because every month, I'm going to try and learn something new. Something like a party trick, something that I can put into my little book of things that I know how to do that I can just pull out whenever I need it. So, juggling is one of them. I have these all ready to go. Still smell great. Still smell so good. Still can't remember what it is that they smell. You know what? I think I finally figured out what it smells like. Thank you, Mike. They smell like bounce houses. Or those slides. Like all those inflatable bouncy places. When they're not dirty. Oh my god.
Juggle? How about juggle these nuts?
I would if I knew how to do it, but I'm saving that for probably February. Also, what is this? Do you see my little Discord at the top right? Whoops. Definitely smells like a bouncy castle. Yep. Love it. Nostalgia. Okay, I'll meet you in February then. Also, new name? Excuse me? Who is this man in my chat? Who's that? D3R Games? Did someone, like, go through puberty? I'm actually new here. Oh, my bad. My bad. I mean, it says next to your name that you are a 17-month subscriber. But, of course, brand new. Yeah. First-time chatter. I'm pretty sure you are the most of the chatters to have ever existed on my channel. You've been lurking for a while. Subbing in the off streams. Mmm. You mean like this one?
Kappa.
Just kidding. He actually did that on stream the other day, but it wasn't working. Was there anything else that wasn't working that they need their validation? I guess Grunge didn't get it. And he's tier 3 now? Oh my god. I never noticed. Incredible. I'm so sorry, Mike. You should get that looked at. I'm very secretive with how I do it. Of course. There have been a few people, though, in reality, that have been lurking for over a year. And I don't know how that's happened, unless someone I knew... No, it said first-time chatter. Make it make sense. It's like cold weather, therefore, the people that normally go out in the summer times, they're all huddled back in, inside. No one can look at it without paying. So far, I have no takers. Anyway, I found this course online, and we're going to learn about bartending. I don't know how much you guys know about it, but I know about zero. I figured it was about that, Mike. I just couldn't figure out the wording. So what is that y'all do here normally? Oh my god. Not this. Not this. Tell you what. Okay, I need to be able to show what's on my screen. How do I show what's on the internet? Do-do-do-do-do-do. Ooh! There's the playlist I was playing. Cool. Now we're actually gonna hop into one of these bad boys. Can I get Discord off the screen, please? There we go. Whoop! Is this loss? Yeah. All right. So I don't have the premium account. If we get through all the basic stuff and I decide... Are they individual prices? Ooh, that's rough. Because there is one that's like a 10-day free trial on the entire thing. And I would love to do that if I feel like I need to go above the basic stuff. Wow, you really are acting like it's new, like you're new here. New year, new you. What's your New Year's resolution? I feel like yours is starting over. Okay. Starting over fresh. This is the one that we'll be looking at first. It's 30 minutes long. I thought that's perfect for a stream, eh? Apparently we get a certificate out of it. Or I do. You don't.
Hi, guys.
Hi, guys. I need better quality than 270p. Thanks. 180 would be great. I'm so excited. New Year's resolution? What are you talking about? It's like the middle of June. Okay. Let's watch this. Let's see what this guy is about.
Hi, guys.
Can you please update the quality?
I've got loads of different tools behind the bar.
There it is.
It can get all a little bit confusing, so I'm going to break them down for you.
I have a notebook.
These are the tools of the trade.
Hi, Sam.
Starting simply with your mixing glass. Your mixing glass can really be anything. This one's a little bit fancy, but if you have a pint glass at home, or if you just have a jar, it'll work just as fine.
Okay.
You use this to make stirred drinks.
D3R.
Next, you have your cocktail shakers.
I know what that is.
This formation with tin on tin is known as a Toby shaker, but anything that has a seal, you can use as a shaker. They simply go in like this, and you shake.
I actually know one thing. Let's go.
And then you have your measuring device. We call these jiggers. This is a 60-30 formation, but if you have a 30-15, that's just fine. As long as they're accurate, you can use that.
I didn't know that was for measuring. That makes sense, though.
Three different types of strainers.
I'm so new.
That all serve a different purpose. This is one you've probably seen the most. This is called a Hawthorne strainer and simply fits over the shaker tin so you can strain out the ice and any other ingredients. Yes. This is a julep strainer. This goes over the mixing glass component of your drink and serves exactly the same purpose as the Hawthorne strainer.
Got it.
And then you have your fine strainer. This is used in combination with either the julep strainer or a Hawthorne strainer.
I kind of have one of those for my matcha.
Any
in fact, I got matcha right here.
Or shards of ice out of
it. Hey, straight shooter. Happy New Year.
Then you have your fruit peeler or your vegetable peeler. This allows you to carve out twists from your fruit and serves as a garnishing tool.
I was looking at some of these previews for these courses, and every time they bring up the fruit and garnishes, I'm just reminded at how complex bartending really is. Did he just say shards of ice? Did he? I mean, I'm sure he said shards, but... That's great. Matcha, what's the matcha with you? the previews of these videos, they look so... sophisticated. It's such a different world. Like, I've done baristaing before, and I like it quite a lot. So the reason I'm looking into bartending is because my brain just, like, fried away. It's because I like making drinks a lot. I like making drinks way more than food. I like making them look pretty. And the great thing is I don't really like the taste of alcohol. So it's a pro and a con. The con is that I don't really know if what I make is super great, probably because I don't really like the taste of any alcohol enough that I would finish it really easy. But the pro is that I could make a lot of drinks and not, like, want to get drunk on the job, and I could just, like, make drinks and get to be creative and stuff, which is really cool. You're just tending to a metal bar. Yeah, yeah. Kind of.
It's always good to have a small assortment of knives, one a paring knife and one a chef's knife. The paring knife you would use for smaller fruits like limes or lemons, and then the chef's knife for things like pineapples or melons.
Okay. I was about to be like, what's a big knife for?
A microplane is quite handy to have in your toolkit, as it allows you to grate hard garnishes like nutmeg, cinnamon, or coffee bean.
Oh.
Of course, you can't stir your stirred drink without a stirring spoon. This is a fancy one from Japan, but anything will do. You can even use a chopstick. This is an ice pick. Really handy to have when you're dealing with large blocks of ice.
Ooh. Ooh. Wait. A giant ice pick. Like, you just... Can you do that with one of those big square ones?
And then you have your citrus juicer. This is a nice handheld design. Sturdy, cast iron.
Yeah, straight shoot.
And you simply put your sliced limes in here, or your sliced lemons if they're small enough, and squeeze. So there you have it, guys. Obviously, there are loads more tools that we can use, but these are the basics. If you have all this stuff in front of you, guarantee you can make a good cocktail.
I should know how to do lobotomy just because I went to OU. Rate this lesson? I don't need to rate it. How to measure? Yeah, next one. Nice work. You've earned a bartending credit. I didn't even do anything. I kind of want to be quizzed. Do I want to go back to school? Yeah. I want to be quizzed. Oh, well.
Hi, guys.
Hi.
We're going to talk today about measuring. And measuring is one of the most important things you do with a cocktail. Much like a baker or...
This is so great because I am a measurer. My mom and I were talking. We've talked about this many times that she is a cook. And cooks kind of guess about their measurements oftentimes. And I'm like more of the baker type. I do everything exact to the measurements because I know that it'll turn out good because the person making the recipe measured it for me and it was good then. So this is perfect for me. Measuring, yes. I might give you lemons, make combustible lemons. Mm-hmm.
Or pastry chef, even if you're out by a little bit of syrup or a little bit of sour, it's going to completely throw off your cocktail. And the simple way to measure is with your measuring tools. These
are
what we call jiggers. You'll see a lot of fancy cocktail bars have got a lot of fancy jiggers, but essentially they're all the same. They will all either have a 30 mil and a 15 mil cup.
Love that.
And some of them have got more.
I never realized how cute and
way,
convenient those are.
This is your weapon of choice. And to practice at home, just take a bottle, fill it up with water, and...
Hold on. He said, this is your weapon of choice. Just the context. This is your weapon of choice, not the chef's knife from earlier. We don't talk about that.
Attach a speed pour and practice.
I don't have a...
Start practicing pouring 30 mils, then you can start practicing pouring 15 mils.
I can't. Do I need to have one at home? Is that something
Measuring
I should buy?
Measuring is very, very important, not just for the balance of a cocktail, but also for the business. If you start over pouring by even 5 mils or 10 mils throughout the night, you're going to be wasting a lot of stock. And when you're practicing at home, don't be afraid to make mistakes. Overpour or underpour your drinks and see how they taste. Maybe not in the bar, but definitely in your own home.
This is what the very first thing we did at my very first job working at Grater's Ice Cream as an ice cream scooper was just scooping ice cream and putting it on our little scale over and over and over to make sure that the size of our scoops was within the brackets. And before every shift, we had to do 5 scoops in a row. Before we could start serving anyone, we do 5 scoops and we write down the weight on a piece of paper every shift. So this has to be like a, once you get the feel for it, you know exactly how long to pour.
And you'll see how much measuring makes a difference to a cocktail.
Was that it? Essential cocktail making techniques.
Hi, guys.
Hey.
In this lesson, we're
going to
do
that every time.
3 basic cocktail making techniques. That is stirring, shaking, and building.
Building.
For a stirred cocktail, you'll need a mixing glass,
uh-huh,
your measuring device, and a bar spoon. I'm going to start off by making a Manhattan.
Yes.
So, I'm going to pour in
Manhattan.
A good double of bourbon, some sweet vermouth.
Okay.
Just a single.
Is a single the 15 and the double a 30?
Stirred drinks are reserved for those drinks that are mainly composed of a spirit, liqueur, or fortified wine, or bitters for this matter.
Hold up. I'm writing that down. I have a notebook.
Stirred drinks are reserved for those drinks that are mainly composed.
Stirred drinks. Composed.
of a spirit. For those drinks that are mainly composed of...
Did you say composed of spirits?
A spirit, liqueur.
Oh, composed, okay. That's my stuff.
Or fortified wine.
Fortified wine.
Or bitters for this matter. You don't want to shake these style of drinks because they get too aerated, they get a little bit foamy, and they over-dilute the drink.
They over-dilute the drink? Okay, don't stir because they get too much air. Yeah. They get too much air, too foamy, or get too diluted. I'm not writing my notes quite like I used to in school. Kind of all over the place, but will I ever look at this again? Maybe not. But there is an acting technique where you write down your lines. You just write your lines over and over and over, and the process of writing it makes you think about it in the moment, and it helps you memorize. So I have a different brain ever since I graduated college.
So add ice to your mixing glass, plenty of ice as well, so it sits well above the level of the drink, and simply put your spoon in and stir. As you can see, this is a more gentle way of blending a cocktail, or blending the ingredients of a cocktail.
How does that even blend it that much? It doesn't look like it's blending anything. I'm learning, CJ.
You want to stir for about 20 to 30 seconds, depending on how strong you'd like it. But a good way to tell when a stirred drink is finished is when the ice becomes level with the liquid.
Ooh, that's a good fact. Yeah, CJ, I'm Long Island, I see. I mean, for all we know, I might work at a bar where you can come visit me, CJ. Hi, Brooding. I don't know how to make a Long Island iced teas yet. Okay, good way to know. Hold on, I'm writing this down. Good way to know if drink is stirred. Hello, Bob Ross of War. It's stirred enough is when the liquid is at the same level, same height as the ice. My God. D3R.
So as an example,
yes,
you can see we're nearly there, but it's still sitting above the liquid, so we're going to keep stirring.
How does that work? Hold
that
up.
Looks just about right.
Hold up. Hold up. Can someone explain the science behind that? How was he able to mix the liquid? And is it because like the ice was got more condensed and could... And when you stir it, it puts them all together. What? Yeah. Bob Ross, please help. I just want to know the science. No clue. The ice melt. It wouldn't melt that fast, though. Right? I mean, you're filling it up super high with ice. And it that liquid started so low. It, like, went in the cracks of the ice, maybe. You are introducing energy into ice. That can't be right.
Right to me. But proof is in the pudding. Give it a little taste.
I'm not going to know if it's good, though. That's the problem. I'll have to, like, shove it in someone else's mouth.
Good.
Yo, is this good?
Grab your julep strainer. Place it on top of the mixing glass. Pull out a chilled glass. And making sure your julep strainer is secure onto your mixing
glass. I've made pasta enough times to know what this is about.
And then garnish it with whatever way you see fit. I'm going to use an orange slice. Set that over the top.
I'm so... Oh! Hold on, can we get a replay of that? Spritz? Oh my God.
I'm going to use an orange slice.
Hold on. That was cool.
Says that over the top. Pop it in, and there you have a very simple...
Hold on. I need three times the charm, for real. Let's go. It's just so beautiful.
Says that over the top. Pop it in, and there you have a very simple stirred cocktail.
I played it three times.
I'm going to demonstrate that beautiful. To you now a shaken cocktail. The reason you would shake a cocktail as opposed to stirring or building is because you have ingredients in there that need to be bound together with a little bit of force. So in this case, we're going to make a Tommy's margarita, which contains lime juice, some syrup, and some tequila. So to get started, we're going to use a Toby shaker today, which is a two-part tin.
I'm sorry. I need to backtrack a little bit because I did not hear what he was saying. I was not paying attention. Like, did he say something important about what kind of drinks get shaken?
So to get started, So in this case, we're going to make a Tommy's margarita, which contains lime juice, some syrup, and some tequila.
Yeah, he has.
So to get started, we're going to use a Toby shaker today, which is a two-part tin. And we'll build the cocktail inside the smaller half of the shaker.
So in with our lime juice. Half. Why? Why the smaller half?
Some agave syrup. And tequila.
I feel like I should be writing this down, but I'm not ready for recipes.
So the key to shaking is lots of ice. Put your shaker on top like that, bigger half on the smaller half. Give it a little bit of a nudge, and then what you have...
Hold on. Okay, shaken. Who's taking notes with me? Because it's not the size, it's how you drink it. Mm. Shaken, what do you call it? Mix in smaller half of shaker. Big side shaker on top and nudge it in and like bop it in. I'm gonna put in and bop it in because that's the closest thing. Bop it in to seal. That makes sense.
Have, or what you should have, is a nice little magic seal. Now the best
Again,
way to shake,
that's magic.
To go about shaking,
that's science.
Is to think, we want to add dilution, we want to add aeration, and we want to mix all those ingredients together. And the way to do that is to imagine the ice going back and forth in the shaker. That's
okay,
the reason
brooding,
you shake, and that's how you should shake. Like so. Once you're shaken, once it's a little bit too cold to hold, you want to break the shaker. And you do that by cracking that little crescent there with the heel of your palm, like this.
Or don't, I'm not your real mom. Yeah. After shaking. Break seal. Please lurk though, brooding. Please.
And there you have your shaken cocktail.
Wait. Once it's too cold to hold, I'm putting in parentheses. When it's too cold to hold. Great.
Now you want to move quick.
My new idea was all right.
Because as this drink sits on ice, it's diluting.
It wasn't that special.
We're going to pour it over some fresh ice in a tumbler. Grab your Hawthorn strainer, which is the attachment for this shaker, and strain. We'll garnish it with a lime wedge. And there you have it.
He garnishes so well.
People tend to just stir, blend, shake, or swizzle. But building has its place. I'm going to demonstrate this by starting off by making a Scotch highball.
Scotch highball.
So, Building is the easiest way to make a cocktail in terms of technique. Because really
you're not
take much.
Stirring.
In the glass, we've got our double of scotch. And from here, we simply add ice. Top it with our mixer, which in this case is ginger ale. And then we add a simple garnish, which in this case is a lime. The reason I would have built this cocktail is because we're dealing with carbonation. And with carbonation, you can't stir and you can't definitely not shake. So you
building with carbonation. I mean that's simple. That's just common sense. And definitely can't shake. Does anybody else have the issue of now that you're not in school anymore, if you go to write stuff down, like especially if you're writing in a journal or something where you're writing a lot, you're so used to autocorrect that put to your like a pen and paper, there is no autocorrect. So it's like, if I spell definitely wrong, that's just, that I just have to deal with it. Scary.
So you want to keep the bubbles in there, and you only maintain this by pouring it in the glass, building from the bottom up. That's the Scotch highball. And then what I have here is a Negroni cocktail. A Negroni cocktail is made up of gin.
Should I be writing this part down? Like, should I have a separate Scottish highball? Or should I just like not keep track of all that yet? Yeah, Bob Ross. Maybe I should have another thing open, like cocktails. No one is going to change it to duck, true. Oh, right, I have matcha. No, maybe that's okay. They'll teach me later. I'm so sorry, Yasmin.
Sweet vermouth and Campari in equal parts. And I've simply placed that in the glass already. To finish this drink, I simply add a nice large block of ice.
Ooh!
This would be considered a build as well because we're not stirring or shaking or any of those other techniques I mentioned. But the reason we would build a Negroni in this case is to have more control over your dilution. Adding this block of ice into the drink starts the dilution process and starts the chilling process. All we have to do is simply stir, garnish, orange twist, and serve.
That's spritz.
Now, because the Negroni is a strong drink and a sipping drink, it's one that we would have over time.
Okay, all alcohol is sipping drinks to me. So I feel like a Negroni would be very scary for me.
Something you wouldn't rush into. And that's the reason we build, because we want to control the amount of dilution in there. By using that big block of ice, it's going to slow the dilution rate. Therefore, you're able to enjoy your cocktail at that great strength for longer.
So you're saying because you're using a bigger block of ice and one block of ice, it dilutes slower than if you put it with a bunch of cubes of ice. That's interesting. I guess I should write that down. Also, my mic isn't cutting in and out, is it? Does it sound okay? Sounds good to you? Okay.
So there you have it, guys. Three different cocktail making techniques. You have the stirred, the shaken, and the build. The stirred, remember, reserved for drinks made up of primarily spirits and liqueurs and bitters to give you that silky texture. You have the shaken, which allows you to combine spirit with juice and syrup. And then you have the build, not just a simple way of making a cocktail, but keeping in mind the carbonation and to keep in mind the strength of the drink.
Okay. How to garnish. That one can't be too hard, right? Oh, there's a quiz at the end.
My name's Charlie, and I'm the co-owner here at This Must Be the Place in Sydney.
I have to remember all this.
I'm going to show you three different ways to garnish your cocktail. We'll run through the...
Yasmin and Mike, I appreciate your comments so much. There. You like that?
Citrus twist, the mint sprig, and the grated garnish. Garnishes have the...
Hold on. There is a quiz. I need to write this down now.
And the grated...
Okay. I should be writing this down in colors. I have pens for this. I went to school. I was one of those girls that had different colored pens for things. That's why in the old days the refrigerator was a hole in the ground with a giant block of ice. It could have a lake, then they covered it with sawdust and absorbed the cold. Right! And I was always fascinated by those pictures or videos of, not the milkman. The milkman's not the person who delivers ice. I think he's called the Iceman, right? He just claws out a giant block of ice and delivers it to your door. Okay. Garnishing. Yasmin seems like someone who liked to decorate her, her studying materials, her notes. Like your notebooks with different colors and little drawings and stuff, like me. Garnishing. If I were in actual school, I would definitely make a whole page for this with beautiful flowers and fruits. But alas, this is kind of a speed run. Citrus. I spelled citrus wrong. I think it's because of my friend Cletus. Thanks, Cletus. Citrus twist. Mint. Sprig. Grated. Whatever that third drink is, it looks delicious. I kind of wish it wasn't alcoholic. Citrus twist seems easy enough.
Garnishes have the power to transform a drink, whether visually or with aroma. They can be tuned to the seasons, and they can provide just a little bit more flavor and a little bit more oomph to your drink. I'm going to demonstrate for you a simple twist. I'm going to use a lemon today, and all you have to do is take a potato peeler or a vegetable peeler and simply go from north to south.
Potato peeler. I would not have gone north to south. I definitely would have gone east to west. So that's good to know.
Once you have your lemon twist, give it a nice trim.
Ooh.
And apply it to the top of the drink. Now I've got a simple martini here. Now you can use this on any stirred drink, things like Manhattans, Old Fashions, and Martinis.
You never use a potato peeler. What do you use, just a knife? From it. Used on stirred drinks.
Are perfect with a lemon. Things like Manhattans, Old Fashions, and Martinis.
Manhattans? Did you say old fashions? Martinis?
Martinis?
Okay. I just never peel my potatoes. I love peeling potatoes. That's one of my favorite things to do when I'm cooking. My mom made something with potatoes when I was at home and she was peeling potatoes. And I'm like, I can take over. She's like, please take over. You got it.
Are perfect with a lemon twist. Simply take your trimmed lemon twist, snap it over the top, which releases all the essential oils, and
hold on. I didn't give myself enough space for this part.
Simply place it.
I just love the way he does that.
Hold on. Simply take your trimmed lemon twist.
Ever tried to rub it? Yes, it's kind of delicious.
All the essential oils, and simply place it in the drink. And there you go.
And place and drink. Raw potatoes taste so different from a cooked potato, but I'm a fan.
A simple lemon twist. All right, guys, and now we're talking about the
mince brig. Tastes like dirt, kind
of. The mince brig. Or any herbs brig for that matter. It can be basil or sage or anything like that.
Basil.
Is a great way to garnish your drink and provide a really, really great visual element to it. It looks fresh, it smells fresh, works with tropical drinks, and works with tall drinks such as this.
It's a tall drink.
For your sprig, you want to get a nice bit of mint and take off that top crown.
No, Dakota, I'm up.
Of the leaf, and simply agitate it a little bit. This releases all the essential oils in the mint, and simply place it on top. Essential oils in the mint, and simply of the leaf.
What's that wording you used?
Mint, and take off that top crown.
Take off. Agitate it. These notes are not very easy to read. That's my B. Oh, you're going to bed, Dakota? Okay, good night then. How long ago you started Portal 2? I know.
I know. Of the leaf, and simply agitate it a little bit. This releases all the essential oils in the mint, and simply place it on top. And there you have it, the humble mince brig. You can use the mince brig garnish in drinks like a Moscow Mule, a dark and stormy such as this. This one, or even a Mai Tai.
How do you spell Mai Tai? I'm guessing. I'm not going to tell you how I spelled that. It's time a cake.
Mm. They're generally used with tropical drinks and drinks that need that little extra aroma, that little extra herbal kick. It doesn't necessarily need to be in the drink, but having it on top just shows a nice fresh element. It's visually stunning and it smells great. Another great way to garnish a drink is to grate hard spices on top. This is used particularly in dessert cocktails. Things like a coffee cocktail, a Brandy Alexander.
What is a Brandy Alexander? Because, oh my God, does that look good?
Or anything with cream, but not limited to.
Brandy Alexander. I think I'm going to write this on the page before it and be like, that's what I want to try next time I go somewhere.
All you have to do is simply take a microplane and grate whatever hard spice you'd like on top. You can use a coffee bean, you can use cinnamon quill, but today I'm going to use nutmeg.
I see.
To do this, you simply grate the nutmeg over the top.
Ooh!
Not too much, as you don't want to flood the drink with nutmeg, because this kind of garnish goes into the drink. But it does provide a nice warm layer on top. A much warmer spice, a much warmer aroma, unlike a mince brig or a lemon peel. This appeals particularly to winter-style drinks.
I mean, that's just
so there you
what
have
I like in
three
general.
Different ways to garnish a drink.
Doesn't
Remember
it though? It looks so good.
The drink can be transformed with the simple use of a garnish, whether it's a mint sprig to provide that fresh seasonality to the drink, whether it's a citrus twist to bring out the more softer, delicate flavors in a martini or a Manhattan, or whether it's a grated garnish like nutmeg or cinnamon, adding a winter feel to your cocktail.
Coffee bean, nutmeg, cinnamon. I spelled cinnamon wrong. I know how to spell cinnamon. Adds warm feeling, like, I don't drink though. I mean, I don't like most alcohol either, so. Adds warm feeling. I wonder what the test will be like at the end of this.
So whatever the garnish is, that garnish can give you just a little bit more oomph to the cocktail.
Yeah, sure I do. Picking the right ice. Ooh. New page for me.
Hi guys. We're here talking about ice today. And ice is probably one of the least talked about ingredients for a cocktail, but it is one of the most important. What I've got here is three different types of ice commonly used for cocktails. The one you'd be most familiar with is cubed ice. This can come out of your machine, or it can come simply out of your freezer from an ice tray. Used mainly for stirring, used mainly for mixed drinks and the like. And then moving on to crushed ice. Crushed ice is used more commonly in tropical drinks. Think of a...
Hold on. This makes sense. Crushed ice is pretty much everything that I get. Like, Sex on the Beach is a crushed ice drink. Isn't that like martinis too? Tropical drinks. You've never seen The Block before in my life. I've never seen The Block in person. I know he's gonna say, like, it's good for Negronis and stuff.
A Mai Tai or a zombie.
You brought up Mai Tai again. What is a zombie?
Drinks like that go with crushed ice. And then you have block ice. Block ice is a little luxury in bars nowadays. You can make it at home by just filling up a Tupperware container with some water and popping it in the freezer.
That makes it sound so not luxurious. Go on.
Then once it's frozen, you just chip it down to size. We have the luxury of having ice molds here in this bar, but the block ice is...
Is that grapefruit vodka? I want to say no, because I don't really like grapefruit. It's got orange. I think it's got orange juice, pineapple juice. Just plain vodka, maybe. Or, What's the name of it? I don't know. Look it up. It's tropical.
Is for drinks like the old-fashioned, drinks like a Manhattan.
Old fashioned Manhattan. Fred?
Or anything that's strong and stirred and would go on the rocks. You use block ice because the large surface area and the vast quantity of ice you have in a glass slows down the dilution. This doesn't allow your drink to or lose its character. A big block of ice stays colder for longer, and of course, looks really great in a glass. So there you have it. Three different types of ice for three different types of cocktail. Now remember, ice is one of the most underappreciated ingredients in the cocktail world, so make sure you remember to use the right type of ice for the right type of drink.
Cute. The cocktail formula, oh boy. Oh boy.
In this lesson, I'm going to teach you one of the three cocktail formulas that every young bartender needs to know.
Ooh, okay, hold on. Cocktail formulas. New bartenders need to know. I feel like I should be typing this instead of writing it, but...
In this case, the formula I'm teaching you is for a cocktail.
Oh, okay.
First of all, a dash of bitters.
Well, what kind of, is it just called bitters? Like, I thought there was like orange bitters and blah, blah, blah. Just bitters? Is he going to tell me what he's making first? My aunt had those oversized ice cubes at her Christmas party. She is fancy. Cranberry orange, yeah. Mike gets it.
In this case, orange. I'm not going to
write it yet. Orange.
And then?
Okay, so, nice face. So, I'll just backtrack.
Vermouth. In this case, dry. 30 mils, or 1 ounce. And then the spirit, which in this case is gin. And we want to put a double, or 60 mils. Together, these ingredients form a martini cocktail.
But that- Just the martini? Okay, well, hold on. I have a green pen for this. I just feel like using one. Martini. I'm going back to the beginning.
That's just the formula. Form together. And then the vermouth, a dash of bit.
Okay.
This case, well, for a cocktail.
Back to the beginning.
First of all,
dash of orange bitters.
In this case, orange. And then some vermouth. In this case, dry.
Dry vermouth.
30 mils. For 1 ounce. And then the spirit, which in
double.
This case is gin. And we want to put a double, or 60 mils. Together, these ingredients form.
Sorry, what was the thing he was using? Like
a martini. Together.
No, of what? Spirits? Just spirits?
Which in this case is gin. And then
yeah,
the
okay.
spirit.
Okay, sorry.
Which in this case is gin, and we want to put a double, or 60 mils.
Okay, got it.
Together, these ingredients form a martini cocktail. But that's just the formula. What we call the Miss Potato Head Theory is the practice of subbing in one ingredient for another. So this is just a building block to create any form of cocktail. It doesn't have to be gin. You can swap gin for whiskey, you can swap gin for vodka, you can swap it for tequila, you can swap it for scotch. You can swap the vermouth for sweet vermouth, or another aromatic wine like Campari or Lillet. And then the bitters you can swap for, well, Angostura bitters, chocolate bitters, lemon bitters, celery bitters, whatever you'd like. As long as you follow that formula, you're guaranteed to make a balanced drink, and you're always guaranteed to make a cocktail.
I probably could have.
So we'll stir it up.
Written that down better.
We'll strain into a nice frozen cocktail glass.
And he'll garnish it with a lemon.
We'll garnish with a simple lemon twist.
I'm learning.
So there you go. The simple foundation of a cocktail. Remember, 2 parts spirit, 1 part aromatic wine or vermouth, and a few dashes of bitters.
He should have put that at the beginning. maybe I need to write that down again. I don't know. That's just for a cocktail or for a martini cocktail? Are they different? Or do they coincide? Hey, Robotic Fountain. Yo, what's up, what's up? I'm learning how to be a bartender. I'm getting a certificate right now. There's a quiz at the end. I'm learning all sorts of things. We're not that far into it yet. I just learned the formula for a martini. Martini. two parts. Spirit. One part. Aromatic wine / vermouth. If you ever want to do a Dane Cook impression, the word vermouth just solidified how to do it. Because he's like, because he says the word mouth like mouth. It's in my mouth. More portal digression. I should my steam my right. 2011, can't lose. I played it so soon after Portal 2 came out. Lol. I'm also learning how to be a bartender. I'm going to apply to work at a bar near my house, and I can afford a bunch of those cool...
I'm also... I also hope to get a bartending job, specifically the ones on Broadway.
And technically, you can go in without really knowing anything, but maybe this certificate thing, this little tiny certificate, will help me.
Together, you...
Oh, I didn't finish writing. A few dashes of bitters.
Form a cocktail. But no matter where you are in the world, you know, cocktails have been named after films, they've been named after cities. They fit moods, they fit occasions. So no matter what, there's always a time for a cocktail.
Thank you for the 10 bits. I just earned a bartending credit. If you want this little certificate where you can follow along, it's free. And we can watch together. I mean, you're watching it here, but I mean, you can also get your certificate that way.
This lesson is all about the foundations of a cocktail. And this one in particular, we're going to run through the sour. The sour is easily one of the most...
That's from a traditional family of mixed drinks. Common example of the margarita and sour. Okay. Sour belongs to the original cocktail family. Subscribe to your Thomas. How to mix drinks. Sour. I'm using orange because that's the pen I have closest to me. How much is it to get it officially, though? The certificate? As far as I know, not anything. Not this course. This is a beginner course. It only takes about 30 minutes if I were to just play it and not talk, but yeah. If I feel like I want to get more advanced, then there is a paid... There are paid courses in addition, but this one's doing pretty good so far.
Most important cocktail foundations or cocktail formulas out there. This is the make or break of a bartender, and it contains just three ingredients, but it's three ingredients that sing when they're in balance.
Ooh.
It's a shaken cocktail. Shake. So to start, lemon juice, our sour element. One part. 30 mils. The second ingredient is our sweetness, which is the sugar syrup. And to note, this is sugar syrup that's been cut 1-to-1. That means that there's one part sugar to one part water. And we're gonna add the same amount we did with lemon juice, which is one part, or 30 mils. The third and final ingredient is your spirit, or your strong, and in this case, it's gin.
I forgot the second I in spirit, and I wrote it as spurt.
So just to reiterate, two parts of spirit, one of sour, and one of sweet. That's it. Shake it up.
He's gonna write it again, right? With all the parts.
Remember, we want a nice, aggressive shake. Crack your shaker. Pour it into our glass. A little bit of ice.
I was gonna say, you're not using your crushed ice for that?
And maybe we'll garnish with a nice lemon twist for aromatic purposes. And there you have a basic sour. Now, to many of you, this might not seem like a familiar cocktail. But the truth is, if I swapped the sugar syrup for orange liqueur, what you would have here is a white lady cocktail. If I swapped the gin for tequila, you would have a margarita. If I had cognac, Cointreau, and lemon juice, I would have a sidecar. If I swapped it for citrus vodka and added a little dash of cranberry, I'd have myself a cosmopolitan. This is what we mean about the formulas and foundations of the sour. The sour, in its simplest form, is strong, sweet, and sour. But it opens up endless possibilities in the cocktail world.
Hold on, you didn't put the little... Hold on.
This lesson...
Hold on. Was there ever the text that said sweet, sour? Okay. Sour. One part sour. One part sweet. Two parts spirit. Are they always shaken? So martinis are stirred. And sours are shaken unless you specify otherwise. Am I right?
A little bit of ice.
Take me to the next part, yeah. Ooh, we're getting there. The plunge cocktail. How to keep your bar clean. The life of a modern bartender turning bartending into a career. Okay. Next part.
In this lesson, we're learning about the foundations of a punch, one of the three building blocks to creating many, many cocktails.
I'm out of colors to use. I guess I'll just go back and forth. But no, I have pens for this. This is worth getting. This is why I have all these pens in the first place. Punch, I want to use a pink. Do you make New Year's resolutions? Absolutely I do. I try to make them broad enough that it's very, very difficult not to achieve them. For instance, I started doing that kind of thing in 2017. But 2018 was a big deal. I called it Reinvent 2018, and I kind of wanted to reinvent myself. But I already knew that I would be studying abroad in Europe, in London, for like 4 months. So it was kind of inevitable that I would reinvent myself. And I traveled a lot that year. I like went to LA. I studied in Manhattan for the first time. And then 2019 was all about making connections, which was bound to happen because I was graduating college and moving to New York City. So that 2020, I didn't have one because I did, and then I forgot what it was because 2020 happened. 2021, I don't remember what that was either. Hi, kids. I was hoping you'd still be going. I guess we're a little over halfway done with this course, but I'm just beginning. There's going to be a big quiz at the end. You guys can help me if you want. I don't know how much you know about bartending kit. We've learned the martini formula and the sour formula. Pretty simple. I'm going to use pink for punch. We're about to learn punch. I'm just going to
was going to say random stuff. Oh, and then this, yeah, 2022's resolution was called Proof, which was all about, like, showing off all the things I've done in my career, including that year. And I did a lot of stuff last year, but... because I was kind of in a place where someone made me feel like I wasn't that I didn't have that many achievements, I guess, that they were, like, better than me. And I wanted to prove that I am, in fact, cooler than them, actually. And it worked. I know a lot in theory, just enough to get me drunk in practice. Right, like, I know how to order things, but it's different than making it for me. All right, let's do this. This year is called Mystique. Hopefully it's that I keep my life a little more private, but on Twitch, that is kind of hard to be the case. Because here I am. And part of it is I want to learn all the kinds of random stuff that I can. Like, I'm going to learn how to juggle. I'm going to hopefully learn how to lockpick. I'm going to learn how to be a bartender. I'm going to learn, like, party tricks. And different skills that aren't acting. Was that person? Yeah, okay. Anyway, punch.
The punch, as the old saying goes, is one of sour, two of sweet, three of strong, four of sweet, and spice.
That's a lot.
There's five elements to this drink. And we're not going to go by the old formula, as it's a little bit old hat. We're going to adapt it ourselves to make a cool, refreshing drink. This can easily be adapted to large format, as in a punch bowl or in a jug. But we're just going to do a single serve.
I really should have learned how to do this in college, huh?
So, to start with, we're going to do just one shot of bourbon.
That's 30, right?
Punches are supposed to be easygoing drinks, stuff that you can have in the afternoon or at a barbecue, so you don't want to put too much liquor in there. But to give it a little bit of aromatic...
Hold on. Easygoing drink. Not that, I'll say strong, not that strong. The best bartenders are at least 30. Wait, you mean age or you mean how much of a shot they put in?
Addicts and a little bit of spice, you're gonna add some sweet vermouth.
How much? One.
Just a little under 30 mils.
A little under, good measurements. Both, yeah.
You're gonna add some sweet.
There's a thing called juggling scars, by the way, that you can use to learn. Are you sure? Are you making that up? Because I honestly don't know. No, I love it. Sweet.
Which will be in its simplest form as sugar.
How
about
much
15 mils.
Okay. 15 mils.
And remembering that sour formula, whatever we have with sweet, we want to balance it out with a sour. So again, 15 mils of some fresh lime juice. To this, we add ice.
I would love to learn to fool.
And to loosen it up, just a little bit of soda water. To finish it off, we'll garnish it with a nice fresh mint sprig. And so there you have it, really simple, really easy punch. One of the foundations of the cocktail world.
Really simple. Wait, hold on. No. Don't make me replay. Hold on. No, dang it. Because I need to... I'm writing it down twice. It's okay. He gave that old
Foundations of version. A Funk 4 of Sweet. Yeah, goes yeah. is one of sour.
I'm gonna write the old one and the new one. Old. One of sour.
Two of sweet.
Two of sweet.
Three of strong.
Three of strong.
Four of sweet.
Four of sweet. Jeez.
And spice. Spice.
New. Is one bourbon isn't sour. What is that supposed to be? A little unfamous sweet from it. Maybe it is sour. It's sweet. No, I'm confused.
So there's five elements to this drink. And we're not gonna go by the old formula as it's a little bit old hat. We're gonna adapt it ourselves to make a cool, refreshing drink. This can easily be adapted to large format as in a punch bowl or in a jug, but we're just gonna do a single serve. So to start with, we're gonna do just one shot of bourbon.
I guess I should just one. What is bourbon? Is that a strong? I think that's a strong. I think bourbon is considered the strong. Now, is a shot the same thing as a part?
Doesn't punches seem are supposed like it. To be easygoing drinks. Stuff that you can have in the afternoon or at a barbecue, so you don't want to put too much liquor in there. But to give it a little bit of aromatics and a little bit of spice, you're going to add some sweet vermouth.
Interesting. I'm just going to put the same thing in one shot. Little under one part sweet. Oh no, that one's really complicated to write. Alright.
Tell world.
What is next? How to keep your
It's often been said that cleanliness is next to godliness. And it's also often said that a bartender is a glorified cleaner. And the two of those go hand in hand. Remember that when you are working as a bartender, you're in the watchful eye of the public all the time. So make sure to act clean and be clean. Every time a drink is spilled on the bar, make sure you've got a rag right next to you so you can wipe down the bar top. Every time you make a drink, make sure that your shakers are cleaned, they're put back into the right place, and you wipe down your workstation as well. Everything has its place in a bar. Knives go a certain place, chopping board goes a certain place, fruit goes a certain place.
I'm really starting to understand why you would hit on bartenders. They got this whole persona.
All of these lend into the speed of a bartender as well. And don't forget, look the part. Make sure that your hands are clean. If they're not clean, wash them, and wash them constantly. You don't have to be clean shaven, but as long as you look well kept and have your clothes ironed and pressed, you'll look the part of a bartender.
That was the fastest video. Got it. We're only two parts away. I'm getting a little
People have come to the realization that Again, this so isn't informal. Just about making drinks. The modern bartender is a bartender that is aware of their place in the bar. They know that they are here first and foremost for people. If you're not a people person, if you don't like people, you don't like serving people, then get out of the industry, because that's what it's all about. The modern bartender is someone that takes care of their guests, makes them feel welcome, makes them feel at home, and makes them feel better than when they walked in.
You need a neon sign for that, Mike.
The modern bartender is someone that is there day and night, that does the long hours, that's, you know, all the way there till close. The modern bartender is, the idea of this modern bartender is someone that's breaking the myths of bartenders. Maybe there are still some guys out there, but the modern bartender is not the guy that goes home with someone else every night. It's not the guy that just makes drinks and walks out and gets paid. Modern bartender is hardworking. Modern bartender is dedicated. Modern bartender obviously knows a whole bunch of drinks. Modern bartender knows the foundations of all those drinks and the formulas, and the modern bartender right, can tune those formulas to suit their guests, to suit their clientele. There's someone that can have a conversation up and down the bar. It's not just about cocktails that the modern bartender knows, but it's someone that is aware of the sports score, someone that knows a little bit about politics, someone that knows a little bit about radiology, someone that knows what's happening in the world today. The modern bartender is someone that can take care of every single guest in their venue.
And this is really turning into like, nice face. It's good that I'm starting off my resolution with bartending, because the point of my resolution is learning a bunch of different things. And I guess in order to be a bartender, you also have to know a bunch of different things. Actors, no wonder actors are bartenders. They're very similar.
You don't see a lot of that nowadays, but there is definitely a culture brewing in the cocktail world. There's been this small revolution in the cocktail world for the past 10 years that is relearning what the role of this barman
really
is or was. And it's for the good. Because for a good couple of decades, there wasn't that. If you think about cocktails in the 70s or the 80s or even the 90s, we were kind of in a dark period. You know, we were using a lot of fake syrups and liqueurs and artificial flavors. Fresh fruit wasn't even in the cocktail. They were extremely boozy. You know, ridiculous glasses and garnishes and really lewd names.
We can learn together.
That's a kind of era that we needed to go through, but it's an era that's definitely gone now. It's a bit of an image that we don't want to associate ourselves with anymore. You know, so the bartender of the past, the bartenders of the 70s and the 80s, is very, very much gone. And that's when we apply this notion of hospitality to the bartender. And that's where we are today.
I did not get the job. They rehired someone else. Ugh. Before I watch the last one, when I think of a bartender, I very specifically think of... find it. Let me search it, please. I have Spotify Premium. I can do this. I think about this song. Which kit? Can you tell me if you think if I adjusted the key, I could make a really good cabaret song out of this? I really wanna sing this myself.
It's quarter to three. There's no one in the place except you and me. So set 'em up, Joe. I got a little story I think you should know. We're drinking, my friend.
This is gonna get muted out. Oh well.
To the end of a brief episode. Make it one for my babe and one more for the road. I got the routine. Put another nickel.
Do you know this song, kid?
in the machine. Feeling so bad, can't you make the music easy and sad? I could tell you a lot, but you've gotta be true to your code.
Yeah.
Just make it one for my babe. One more for the road. You'd never know it, but buddy, I'm a kind of poet, and I got a lot of things I'd like to say.
I would end my cabaret stream with this
and
song.
And when I'm gloomy,
if I get my friends involved,
won't you listen to
me? If you can think of any off the top of your head, feel free to link me on Discord, like DM me.
Talked away.
I want to have a cabaret string, dang it.
Well, that's how it goes. And Joe, I know you're getting anxious to close.
Am I muted? No.
And thanks for the cheer. I hope you didn't mind my bend in your ear.
Okay. Hi, Ash.
But this torch that I found, it's gotta be drowned, or it soon might explode. So make it one for my baby, and one more for the road.
I wouldn't do the last words he says.
The long.
I would end it with this.
It's
so long. And not do the rest of the words.
The long.
I'm pretty sure he just does that one, but yeah, okay. None of that. Wow, Ash, thank you so much. Yeah, I wanna do that song in my own key. Although, that song sounds so good in its original key, I'm almost nervous about hearing it in a different key. Gosh, how much would I have to bring it up or down? I don't know. Anyway, this is the last course before we take our little quiz.
You know, in the past, bartending really kind of got you nowhere. Bartending is a job, or was a job, that seemed to be a little bit of a dead end. You know, there was no career, there was no future in it. But that's very much changed now. I can speak personally that bartending can take you around the world. Remember, this is a job that is around the world. There are bartenders in every city you go to. So not only does it allow you to travel, you're already fluent with this language that you've learned.
I like that.
Cocktails have a time and a place anywhere in the world. And cocktails were almost designed to fit those time and places. You know, if you think of a martini, the martini is able to transport you just like music. You know, when I think of martinis, I think of jazz, and I think of jazz clubs in New York.
Oh,
you know, all those things are linked.
It's almost like I did that whole song so perfectly.
Chances are you're thinking of a pina colada, or you're thinking of a Mai Tai, or something like that. You know, and then you start thinking of the steel drums, and you start thinking of the beach, and you start thinking of, you know, whatever it is. And that's a really cool industry to be part of because it's global. You know, this isn't something that's specialized to one town, to one city. This is something that everyone gets involved in and everyone has an experience with, at least. So it's a great way to connect with people. But then when you look at the broader spectrum, bartending competitions nowadays have really gone full scale. They've blown out. Instead of winning a bottle of spirit or maybe a little cash prize in a bartending competition, nowadays, that little cash prize is converted into a plane ticket. say, enter this competition, and if you win, you're in New Orleans, or you're in New York, or you're in London, or you're in Paris. So it's come a long way from just being that job that you had in university to pay the rent. Bartending has gone full scale now. It's a community, it's a family, and now it's something that you can actually make a career out of.
Okay. Go to quiz. All right, here we go, guys. You can help me. Oh, this is a real quiz. To pass, you need to correctly answer 18 out of 22. I think we can get them all right. How do you say that? I'm already on a bad start. Cognac? Cognac. I don't know. Orange liqueur and lemon juice are the ingredients for which cocktail? Oh, I didn't write those down. Well, the orange liqueur, and I think I did write it sort of down. Right? Hashtag inspiring. Orange liqueur and lemon juice is not a mark. It's a white lady, right? Because he's like, if you switch it with this and this. Oh no, what a bad start. Why didn't I write that one down? I'm going to skip question one. We're coming back to question one. Question two is, what is a bartender trying to achieve when adding an ice cube with a large surface area to a cocktail? That is for slowing down dilution. What was cocktail culture in the 1970s and 80s known for? Fake syrups, fresh fruit, artificial flavors, low alcohol punch bowls. I'm pretty sure it was fake syrups and artificial flavors, right? I thought he said the 90s. Oh well. Yeah. I know I can look it up on Google. I'm just ashamed that I didn't write that one thing down. The very first question. Low alcohol punch bowls are a thing now. What does snapping and agitating a garnish over a glass do? It releases essential oils from the garnish. What is this strainer called? Oh, I'll have to look that up. I didn't write that one down. What is this measuring device known as? That is a jigger. What is the common language all bartenders share, making it easier to work anywhere in the world? The love of spirits. The techniques to make classic drinks, the ability to work late nights. The techniques to make classic drinks. What's an ideal garnish for stirred drinks? Lemon twist, mint sprig, or grated nutmeg? That would be not grated nutmeg. I think it's a lemon twist. Grated hard spices are often used in dessert cocktails, particularly with those made with what ingredient? Punch, cream, or brandy? I would assume brandy, considering I wanted that Brandy Alexander. It looked very good. No cream, though. What's a cream? What is one of the most important reasons for keeping everything in its place behind the bar? It helps you avoid confusing ingredients, it allows for quicker service, or it looks cleaner. I'm sorry, is it not all three? I mean, it looks neater. But all three. What is a Toby tin? A specialized cocktail shaker. A cocktail shaker with a glass part and a tin part. Tin-on-tin cocktail shaker. What? Skipping that. What's the ideal technique to use if you're using carbonated liquids? That would be building. You don't want to shake or stir something that's carbonated. It's all three, but avoiding confusing ingredients seems the most important. Yeah, but he said it's all about how you look. It's all about being the neat, clean bartender. So it has to be keeping it neat. What other drink could be substituted for vermouth in the cocktail formula?
want to say it for vermouth. Aromatic wine or vermouth. What? I only heard him say you should replace something with tequila. Skipping that one. The cocktail formula asks for spirits, bitters, and what other ingredient? Cocktail. Spirits, bitters, and aromatic wine. Aromatized wine. Yeah. Why would sweet vermouth be added to punch? To make it sweeter? To make the drink stronger for the sweet element of the formula, it adds aromatics and spice. I think it's the sweet element. There's two sweet elements in a punch. He listed two sweets. To make it more alcohol. No, wait. Nuh-uh. Because in a punch, the bourbon is the strong part. The sweet vermouth is not the strong part. Okay, you're like the devil on my shoulder. I don't think it's aromatics. But dry vermouth is an aromatic. Oh my god, I don't know how I'm gonna do on this quiz. What kind of drinks typically use crushed ice? Tropical cocktails. Correctly, I haven't completed that question. Okay, well, I'm gonna look them up later. What can you use to mix cocktails in? Select three. Mixing glass to mix cocktails in? Where did he write this? Where did he mention this? I mean, he's only talking about cocktails. To mix cocktails in. Isn't it a jar? I'm like the angel on your shoulder, but I'm sitting on the wrong side. That's very true. Because, I mean, I want to say mixing martini and pint glass, but that seems wrong. Mixing glass seems right. You wouldn't mix in a martini glass. You would mix in a pint glass. And then... what is a jar? You wouldn't mix in a martini glass because you shake... in the martini glass, and then you pour it in. So that's not mixing it in there. I'll come back to it. What's a good indicator of when a stirred cocktail is finished? When the ice is melted or when the ice is level with the liquid? That one. The ice is level with the liquid. Stirring is a technique reserved for cocktails comprised of spirits, bitters, and what other ingredient? Stirring. Definitely liqueur or fortified wine. Yep, that's it. The patron asks for a refill. What is one of the consequences of overpouring cocktail ingredients? It affects the profits of the bar. Yes, it creates a balanced cocktail. It angers customers. Overpouring wouldn't anger a customer. It affects the profits of the bar. Some of these are kind of tricky, like trick questions, because it could be multiple, but it wouldn't be a balanced cocktail if you overpour. What is a good indicator of a ready-to-serve shaken cocktail? When the liquid starts to seep out of the seal, what a nightmare that would be. When the shaker is a little too cold to keep holding. What is the formula for the sour cocktail? That I have. One sour, one sweet, two spirit. One sour, one sweet. Too strong. Okay. I'm gonna go ahead and do this. Copy. Google. That is a sidecar. All right, I wouldn't have known that. I was totally about to say a white lady. Yeah, that totally helps, Mike. Punch bowls, okay. I want to say it's the Hawthorne strainer. This is what Google is for. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yes. Yes. That's good. Brandy looks neater. Tobyton. Lol. Toby tin copper. Oh, it's the shaker. Specialized cocktail shaker. Cocktail shaker with a glass part and a tin part. Oh, they're all shakers. Well, Toby tin copper. Easy to shake and fits to an embossed tin. Made of stainless steel makes the ideal cocktail shaker. So not the tin and not tin. It's tin meaning? There's nothing, I'm surprised it's not like a definition in the dictionary. Meanwhile, I have a light bright. Oh, I don't know what to put on it, but I want to put it. I used to have a light bright. Let's see. I mean, is there anything you can put on your light bright that's like your New Year's resolution or like something January related in some way? Toby tin is all that is needed. The cheater tin is a simple metal cup that easily fits. So it's a tin on tin. Toby tin, metal tin you can use to upgrade your Boston shaker to a tin on tin shaker. Gosh, I don't remember him bringing that up. What other drink could be substituted for? Oh no. Oh no. I'm not sure I can. Okay, well, I mean something January related. Also, I don't know what your resolution is, I don't think. What other drink could be substituted for vermouth in the cocktail formula? Oh, an aromatic wine, but which one is an aromatic wine? What are these? Hello, brooding. Okay, that's a wine. It's an aromatic grape. Okay. So that should be the answer, I think. Tequila, though. Yes, Kit, take your daily vitamins. That's a big help. I've noticed changes in my hair since I've been taking the edible vitamins. I mean, not like edible, like weed, just like not pill vitamins. From the inside out. Yeah, I still haven't learned to make a Long Island. tequila. My phone is at 11%. Remind me to plug it in. Tequila is distilled. So it's not tequila. It's a liqueur. So that wouldn't replace. That's a spirit. That wouldn't replace the vermouth. But I will look up what a Lilith is. French based wine based. Oh no, I don't know which one it is. Why would it not be both? Yes, I do mean chewable. Because I don't like swallowing pills at all. A little gel pill of vitamin D? I can't do those. Can't do those. One time I bought a whole thing of the pill vitamins and I didn't even have a single one because I opened it up and they were way bigger than I thought they were going to be. It says French aromatized wine. So maybe that's the answer, but I don't remember him saying that ever. I guess that's just using my common sense. You can't do pills either. Yeah. I was trying to find bartending games that would, like, teach me by doing it as a game, but I couldn't find anything besides the VR games. I don't have a VR headset. Bartending jar. Tip jar. So is that not a thing? Was jar never brought up? Unless it's for tipping. So you don't do it in a martini. Seems wrong. That might be wrong. That's done, that's done. That's done, that's done. I want to pass this with flying colors. I'm not sure that I will. 18 out of 22. Oh, I should be fine. Here we go. Drum roll, please. You got 18 out of 22, right? I got just the right amount to do it. Okay, hold on. What did I get wrong? It wasn't brandy? I'm sorry. I totally thought it was and it wasn't to make it look neater? Okay. The vermouth is not additive to be the sweet part. Okay. Well, tell me what the right answers are then. Can I take it again? Well, it's like view certificate. What if I want to do it again? Oh, well. Guess we'll never know. Kit, I'm sorry. You were right. Wow. Attempts. Can I do it again? Attempt one. I guess you don't do it again. All right. There we go. To my stage name. Hopefully, if I get a real job, then, you know. Maybe I gotta put my real name on there, too. There's so many bartenders working. It's gotta be in the same place. Yeah. Yeah, save as downloads. It really should be my real name. Maybe if we sure to write on screen so we can sell it to your enemies. No. Do I have to switch to a different thing? Let you not see what I'm looking at. Hold on while I figure this out. Oh, I should put... Dakota gave me 169 bits. One second. Give me a song. Give me a song. Yeah. Give me a song. While I figure this out. Photoshop my real name onto it. Couldn't I do that? Profile. Switching my name out real fast. That's how they got Al Capone. Hopefully they let me switch it back again. Please. Dang it, it's still to my stage name. What have I done? I guess they could take it. Yeah, if you want to be a liar and a cheat. Okay. Did it say on there what my score was? I don't think it did. It in an Adobe PDF. I don't have Adobe. I mean, that was my fault. This isn't costing me money, but it doesn't look like I can do it again anyway. And that doesn't... It's fine. I got the certificate like I wanted. Also, it hasn't updated to my real name. Well, I'm switching it back to my stage name because we're doing more of these then. I'll be like, well, this is my stage name. Hey, Toxic. Martini, she cannot serve him with a port over vodka with a single olive. I haven't learned anything about olives yet. We're getting there. How you doing, Toxic? I'll do it and write your name. Just pay me an unmarked bills. No thanks. Okay. Now I can show you what I'm looking at again. The Other Reindeer is a great movie, Mike. Such a good movie. Great music. Hold on. Can I play my favorite song from All of the Other Reindeer? It's not Christmas anymore, but you reminded me of something that I'm not going to remember again for who knows how long. It's the Mailman song. It's so good. Now I can show you a few things. Bah, bug and hum. I can already hear it in my head. Now let me show you what I'm... There we go. Found it. I love villain songs.
Oh, no, sorry.
Oh, that's okay, Olive. No harm done.
Aren't you going to kick me or spray me or something?
No, not today.
Wow. I guess
is that
you really
King Julian?
The Christmas spirit.
That's right. The no more Christmas spirit. Did you hear? Santa's not flying. He's through.
Yes, but...
At last. We're breaking the cycle of despair. By next year, people will have forgotten.
You probably
Christmas.
Watched it on Cartoon Network.
What's the matter with Christmas?
The matter? The matter?
In the summertime, the delivering's so easy. My bag is light and the world is fresh, but by autumn I'm getting queasy. The shoulder strap tears at my flesh. I'm a zombie by Thanksgiving. With 4 weeks torture still to come, this is no way to make a living. Christmas, bah, bug and hum.
That Mike Wazowski's Monsters, Inc. sound.
Card. Surely that can't be too hard, but multiply it a billionfold and see why Christmas leaves me cold. Christmas, bah, bug and hum. They cut down bigger, fatter logs so I can bring more catalogs. First class, third class, book, great book. Is it any wonder why I sulk? Christmas, bah, bug and hum.
I want to see this on stage.
Send a friend a 2-ton gift. I don't mind, I love to lift, especially when the weather's freezing. Oh yes, I love the Christmas season. Christmas, bah, bug and hum.
Yes, instrumentals.
By now my ligaments are toast, but here it comes, more parcel post. Why not splurge, send it priority? What's one more pain in my posteriority?
Posteriority?
So here's one vote for cancellation of all that Christmas celebration.
I don't look that great today, Hayden.
That's a start for taking strain off my poor heart. So turn around, go back home, Rover. As of
Chonin,
now,
yo.
Christmas is over.
Hate to disappoint you, but I'm going to the North Pole to save Santa's flight.
You're not a reindeer. You can't fly. You can't do anything.
You wait and see. I'll be zooming right over your head, pulling that sled.
Which rules?
And
do I have
be
rules?
A Merry Christmas, even for you if you let it. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have a bus to catch.
Nobody's going to help that lousy old Santa. Stay away from the North Pole.
It's a good movie.
Or I'll hand cancel you.
Or he'll what? Wait. Or he'll what?
Or I'll hand cancel you!
I'll hand cancel you? This movie's from like, what? I want to say 2004 or something. Reasons I don't chat, one, rules in chat. Did I make rules? I don't even remember. Maybe I did. It's been so long, you know. Welcome back. 1999. Okay. I always knew Drew Barrymore was Olive. I always think about that. Every time I see it. Okay, so here are our courses. We just finished. Is it not there anymore? Beginning bartending. We could do rum fundamentals. No, beverage, please. Gin basics. I think there's vodka basics. Like a rule thing to flame rules. To me, Dan's voice here most reminds me of this robot devil in Future. Yeah, okay. That voice is very familiar. Are you doing a learning stream? That I sure am. We just did a whole thing on bartending. The basics, because I want to be a bartender, hopefully a Broadway bartender. Where you don't really need to know that much going in. But I got a little certificate. And I'm trying to learn. Yeah. Welcome to my New Year's resolution. Yeah, exactly, Jonan, because I don't even like alcohol all that much. But I want to learn how to make it. So, should we do vodka, gin, or rum? What's the most important thing first, do you think? Most essential? I might say vodka. vodka is most useful. Gin is best. Mm. But we're dealing with Broadway. Rum is most fun. Candy is dandy, but liquor is quicker. I think vodka's the way to go. Look at my... I know you can't really see it, but... I was taking notes. Let's do vodka. The first alcoholic drink I ever had when I turned 21. Sake. I love that there's quizzes.
I'm sure many of you out there have had a vodka drink.
You know, before I even clicked on this, I thought this lady reminded me of Cecily Strong. And wow, she sounds like her too. Yeah, I don't necessarily want a diamond ring. Because there's a bunch of alternatives out there. Coding website. What, you don't want to learn coding?
Considering it's the most consumed spirit in the world, there's a good chance you've had this clear good time elixir. But for all of its popularity, it is still one of the most misunderstood spirits in the world. So during this lesson, we're going to talk about a brief history, some of the common misconceptions, and give you a new look on one of the oldest spirits in the world. It's always been a huge debate about who created vodka first. Most historical references will say Russia did, but Poland claims birthplace as of the 8th century, using it for medicine and gunpowder.
I'm gonna have to know this, aren't I? Like, I don't want to remember this. I feel like it's not that important, but... Writing in big letters, vodka. Or y'all can remember it for me. Began in Poland, actually. Eighth century origins, more like vodkas.
And as we know, like any good medicine, this turned recreational pretty quick, becoming the national drink of not only Poland, Russia, and Finland.
I just know I'll have to remember this. National drink. Stopping in, but I will try to be here for a bit. Jonan, can you do me a favor and fill out the survey in my Discord server? It's in announcements because my 2-year anniversary is in 2 days. And you can answer like who you think the best mod is and what your favorite command is and so on and so forth. Answer as many or as little questions as you want. I've only gotten 6 responses thus far.
Its ability not to freeze when being transported across countries didn't hurt either. It wasn't until a popular vodka company was actually forced to leave Russia for over 70 years that vodka actually left the vodka belt and entered America. And that vodka? Smirnoff. Recipe number 21 was created by Vladimir Smirnoff. He was actually banned...
Yeah, CJ, good job.
...banished from Russia for over 70 years during the Bolshevik Revolution. And one of the most extreme examples of denial marketing, it actually had the opposite effect. Smirnoff became one of the most sought-after vodkas in the world. And it wasn't until a very famous man, going by the name of Bond, James Bond, that he turned what was traditionally a gin martini into a vodka-tini. In 1962, in Dr. No, he ordered the first Smirnoff vodka-tini. He changed the entire culture. Smirnoff continued to do product placement in Hollywood, and by 1978, it became the most consumed spirit in the country. Now in the United States, vodka makes up 32%.
No, Kit. There's a difference. I know what you're going to say. You're going to say, ugh, I don't want to have to remember this. No. I'm taking in this information. I just don't want to take the time to have to write it down. I'm enjoying watching it. I just wish that... These are facts that I would forget when the quiz comes up. That's all.
Of the drinks ordered. But listen, people, you can actually make vodka anywhere. from Vietnam right, to Jonah. The Andes to your bathtub, you can make vodka. But before you try your bathtub, check out one of your local distilleries. So what are the common misconceptions about vodka? One of the major misconceptions is that vodka is supposed to be odorless, colorless, and flavorless. That's actually supposed to just disappear in your drink. But nothing can be further from the truth. Vodka definitely has subtle flavor notes, finishes, bites, all that can be enhanced by what you mix it with. Distillers have a specific idea about the finish and the flavor they want. So the idea that you're supposed to taste nothing, well, that just isn't true. Another huge misconception is that all vodkas are made from potatoes. Actually, vodkas can be made from anything. Grapes.
That is such a fact. Vodka can be made from anything. Can they be made from humans?
Sugarcane, corn, even coconut. Anything that you can create a mash from, you can make a vodka from.
Or you can make mash out of a human.
Using potatoes. They consider it a cheaper grain. What you'll find in most Russian vodkas is wheat. Polish tend to use potato and rye. These are the...
Polish. I really angry hedgehog. I need to write down, you can make vodka out of anything that can mash. You can make vodka out of anything you can mash. Great. The monster mash, yes. Can you make a monster vodka? If you distill it, probably,
the
right?
The three ingredients that the vodka belt considers what a true vodka is made from.
That's not the
vodka
zombie cocktail, is it?
Have a range of finishes from earthy, spicy, grainy, clean, even chewy.
Oh my. Hold up. This is blowing my mind, because first she says there's a bite, and now she says the vodka can be chewy. This is very off-putting. I'm going to write it in a different color. Can be earthy, spicy, grainy. What kind have I been having? I think I've only had clean my whole life. Yum, yum, yum.
One of my favorite vodkas is Thai vodka from Vietnam.
She really needs to describe this chewy thing a little more.
Made from yellow blossom rice. It actually rolls on your tongue for 30 seconds, dries out everything in your mouth, and you end up having a chewy finish to it. It's very active.
Again. Jonan, can you describe this at all? Some weird Spice Girls. It dries out your mouth, and then you can chew it. Are you sure it's not just numbing your mouth to a point where you can bite, you can chew your own tongue and you won't notice? I mean...
Well, now that we've got your vodka palates wet, it's time for you to go out
and
talk to customers about it.
They're
but
dry.
Maybe somebody tell a little bit of knowledge will totally change their bar experience.
After I do handstands, what does this mean? Okay, I earned a vodka credit. That's fun. I learned that vodka is chewy. Hi, Grunge, and good night. Absolutely tell the difference. It's not that I don't believe you, it's just that I want to try it. So I know what the
I'm
heck
sure
that's about.
I'm sure many of you have been to a whiskey, wine, tequila tasting. Today we're going to conduct a proper vodka tasting and show you the optimal way to actually taste the natural layer of flavors that these distillers intended. First and foremost, why do most people think vodka tastes like rubbing alcohol? Because they store it like rubbing alcohol on a shelf.
That down? Are they not supposed to? I'm assuming she's about to say, you're not supposed to store it on a shelf. You should store it outside in your garden with the bunnies. So let's go get the alcohol. You can get a dry feeling. Yeah. I thought only certain wines were dry. I guess I've never had dry vodka. Oh. Mm-hmm.
You wouldn't pull a Chardonnay from the shelf and drink it, so you shouldn't do that with vodka either. Mm. It's naturally supposed to be colder. It was made in Russia, people. So the idea is once you put it in the freezer, it actually cuts off that ethanol bite. It may cause the viscosity to thicken a little bit, but you will actually taste a layer of flavors that you weren't able to taste before.
Ooh.
All right, folks, now for the good part. We're gonna do our vodka tasting. So I've picked three different vodkas. The Tito's from Texas.
Yeah, I was kidding. Yes, Jonan. Yes, you're paying attention. Yeah, goodness gracious, you're the same lady. It was made in Poland.
This is made from yellow corn, the Chopin from Poland made from potato, and the Purity from Sweden made from wheat and barley. I chose these three because they have such a different contrast and finish, but you are welcome to choose any three vodkas you like. So I've set it up into half shots, because if you do more than that, your customers are going to be wasted. Also, I'm trying them right now, and I don't need to be wasted. So the first one we're going to go with is the Tito's. This is from Austin, Texas. It's made from yellow corn. The way you actually...
I shouldn't write that. Because these are things I'm going to have to be able to pull off the shelves. So cool. Ohio can produce that pretty easy.
You think it's quality? Is you shoot it. It's not like wine where you swish it around. Everything that happens with flavor happens in the finish. Nastrovia. Tito's I like.
That better be Polish.
A very clean vodka. It was actually created to be one of the cleanest vodkas in the United States. Because it's made from corn, there's a slight sweetness that swirls on the top of your tongue. The bite dissipates almost immediately. Now moving on, this is what I call a full circle vodka. Chopin is one of the most elegant vodkas you'll try. The reason I call it full circle is because after you shoot it, it will start off clean and then transition to a slight grainy sweetness and then transition back to clean, all in one finish. Now, do you taste that? The bite will dissipate almost.
What do you mean, do I taste that? No, I'm not tasting any of it. Hold on.
Takes over the top. Now, the fact
oops.
Is, one in, back to clean.
She said something in it. It starts clean.
The most elegant vodkas you'll try. The reason I call it full circle is because after you shoot it, it will start off clean, and then transition to a slight grainy sweetness, and then transition back to clean, all in one finish.
Back to clean.
Now, do you taste that? The bite will dissipate almost immediately, but that sweetness just takes over the top of your tongue. Really taste how rich that is, because it continues to swirl, and that finish will last for a long time. And then into the last, the Purity. Purity from Sweden. Now this is made from two different things, wheat and barley. So the finish does transition a little bit. Now the fact it's distilled 36 times should make it relatively clean.
Whoa. Here's.
The reason I like Purity
I figured it was
is
Russian.
Because of its lightness, it's almost effervescent. It actually bubbles on the top of your tongue. It's a very active finish. The little legs crawl to the back of your palate, and it stays there. So even though you're not tasting the burn, the flavor is there long after the finish.
She described that like a spider. It crawls back there, its little legs down to the back of your tongue. Whoa.
So there are different
notes such a weird way of describing
vodka. Is it floral? Is it earthy? Is it spicy? Is it clean?
Does floral
it finish
now.
On the top of your mouth? Does it finish on the sides? Does it...
Oh, okay. Where do I write that? Where did I have my list before? Oh, there it is. Earthy, spicy, grainy, chewy. I'm gonna go ahead and add floral. Does it finish top or sides? How weird. I would like to try the difference, though. Ah, you're one of those people.
Does the bite dissipate or does it stay there for a long time? Depending on what grain you use, will totally change the finish. Wheat tends to be cleaner. One bite, one note. You get to potato vodka, you get a lot grainier, richer, fuller flavor. And then the rye, that's your wild card. It will transition from earthy to sweet a lot of times, so my whiskey, my scotch drinkers love a good rye vodka. And we have one more addition to your vodka tasting. If you want to be real Russian about it, most Russian vodka drinkers will have a plate of pickles or caviar to follow their shots.
Ooh, I really want caviar right now. That's so different from wine and cheese. Oh my gosh. next date I go on, they're like, you want to get some wine and have a cheese tasting? I'll be like, no, pickles, caviar, and vodka.
When vodka was originally made, it was crude. It had a large bite to it, so the pickles basically killed that bite so they could keep drinking. Now, it's just an accoutrement to the side. Okay, so now that I've given you the basics of the vodka tour, I gotta give you some homework. Go to your bar and find three vodkas, preferably of different country and grain. Taste them yourself. Put them in the freezer first. And see the different nuances. Try the subtleties, the flavors.
My phone's at 3%.
If you really feel like you're an expert in those vodkas, talk to your boss about doing a flight. Pairing vodka with food is one of the greatest experiences the diner can have, if they can remember it.
Okay, it gives me a few seconds to get my charger. Hold on.
If you're outside of the vodka belt, most likely you're drinking your vodka as a mixed drink.
So she's already continuing. Hold on, I'm not ready for you.
Which popular mixer? If you're outside of the vodka belt, most likely you're drinking your vodka as a mixed drink. So in this lesson today, we're going to go over which popular mixers work best with which vodka. And for the purist out there that like just straight vodka, I'm going to go over how to recommend to your customers which vodka for their palate and possibly how to pair it with food. We're going to start off with your corn-based vodkas. Now, most people don't think of corn when you think about making vodka, but it's actually more prevalent now than you might realize. Corn in itself happens to have a sweet finish to it, and it's very,
I know
very
a lot
clean.
About corn.
So my suggestion is mix it with your soda drinks, the drinks that you want your vodka to disappear in. Vodka soda.
That makes a ton of sense because corn is in every food.
Vodka cranberries, sea breezes, all of those, you won't taste the vodka at all. Next, we're going to go to the wheat. This is Kettle One. This is made from 100% European wheat. Wheat has one note, one finish. It rarely changes. It doesn't go from earthy to spicy. It's just one hit and it's done. That's why I find fruit is the most compatible for this type of vodka. Not only does the vodka complement the fruit flavor, but it keeps that clean finish throughout. I'm a big fan of Cosmos. I also think screwdrivers are excellent for a wheat vodka. Next, we're gonna go on to the potato vodkas. This is the grainiest, heartiest.
You said Cosmos and what?
Next, we're gonna go on to the potatoes. I also think screwdrivers are excellent for a wheat vodka. Next, we're gonna go on to the potato vodkas. This is the grainiest, heartiest base you're gonna have for a vodka. Not only is it full flavored, but it'll actually elongate that salty finish in savory drinks. That's why I've purposely picked a dirty martini. It is actually one of my favorite vodka drinks, dirty Chopin with a splash of Tabasco. Other great drinks, Bloody Mary. Anything savory, it's really gonna help that salty finish and also cut that bite. Lastly, we're gonna move on to Belvedere, rye-based vodka. Now, rye is kind of a wild card. It can go from earthy to sweet. It can have a little bit of a spice at the end. Therefore, it can be put in a lot of full-flavored drinks. Black Russians are actually one of the most popular drinks in the world, and rye vodkas are excellent for that. Espresso martinis, also really great.
Espresso martinis, okay. Well, my mom loves white Russians. Not black Russians, though. What's the diff?
They stand up to that bitter punch with a little bit of spice. So next time you're recommending something
for breakfast
for a mixer,
or brunch,
think about the base. Think about its natural qualities and how well is that going to mix with what you're putting it in. Not only will it help your mixology, but that knowledge alone will help your tips. All right, purists, I did not forget about you. I agree that there is nothing sexier than a straight martini. So we're gonna go over how to recommend these to your customers and possibly pair them with food. Starting off, corn vodka. Now this is the lightest of all the vodkas you're gonna try. It's very, very clean. This particular one, Prairie from Minnesota, is extra buttery. It's super viscous. So I personally like to pair it with a salad, something lighter so they both complement each other, or a tangy dessert. This won't add or subtract from anything that you're eating, but it's such a pure taste that anyone who wants minimal bite will love Prairie. Now, wheat vodkas. This is for your cleaner drinkers. These are the ones that don't mind a little bit of a bite, that really want to taste that vodka. The same way I would pair a wheat vodka with sort of a citrus drink, I would pair it with a lighter dish, a fish or a chicken dish. Something that is not too flavorful, therefore it won't take away the flavor of the vodka. Third, we're gonna go on to your potato vodka.
Hold on, not too flavorful.
Okay. Vodkas. Now this is your full flavored, rich vodka. This can stand up to a ribeye, or it can stand up to a very hearty pasta. It's full flavored, it's got a lot of texture to it, and it goes really well with your heartier dishes. And then our last one, we've got our rye based. And as I said before, this is a wild card. It goes earthy to spicy, it can have slight bits of sweet, it can have a little bit of tang. So with this one, I think you can kind of pair it with almost anything. The sweet complements certain dishes, the spice complements others. All right, so here is what you need to go out and do. I personally have found that vodka drinkers only drink the vodka that they like because they don't know that there's better options out there. So find your vodka
drinker
who comes and orders
all of life
every week, and then expand their horizons. Find out the base and see if there's something else that you could suggest that's in their same wheelhouse, and then maybe something that's totally out of their comfort zone. And again, go to your bar and find out which mixers are most complimentary for which drinks. Having the knowledge of these bases will